guys. So we continue. Our next speech is topping in the charts with 3-person team. So now here is Riley Andersen from Umami Games. So Riley, you're welcome.
Thank you, Vlad, for the presentation, and thank you for having me here today. To start out, we'll just say some people are doing some construction work outside of our office, so it might be a little noisy, but let's hope not. Yeah, so I'll just go in here and make this one big. So today I'm going to chat about how to reach the top charts with a 3-person team. So it'll be some different insights into a hyper-casual game development, which I guess is super relevant at the hyper-casual game conference. Yeah, so I'm the CEO of Umami Games, and we are located in Copenhagen, Denmark, so in the north. We are a very small team. We started out being 3 people. What we believe is that creativity, rapid development, and data testing is like the mix one needs to success in this business. We were founded in 2019, so around 2 years ago, and we already made more, I think now it's more than 40 games. As a founding team, as I said, we are 3 people. So we were 2 technical guys, and then me, I have a background in design and marketing. And then we used to work at Tactile Games, another game studio here in Denmark. So we made ABC Runner, which reached the first place on the US App Store only 3 months after we got the idea. We think that's pretty impressive, being a 3-person team, especially considering we were also doing other games next to this one. So right now it has more than 7.5 million downloads, and I would say it's a pretty good textbook example of data-driven game development. So that's kind of what I will focus on today. How did we actually achieve of being only 3 people and then making a game that actually worked, that we could make money on? So when we design our game, I would say our goal is to entertain a wide audience of people. We want to, of course, also learn as much as possible and also make as much money as possible. I think that's like the standard here in hyper-casual. How do we actually make the money? I think for many hyper-casual developers, it's like these LTV tweaking, where in the end it's super basic, right? You want a LTV, like a lifetime value model, that's higher than what it costs you to get people to install the game. What we're doing, as many others as well, is looking a lot at the metrics and tweaking them. So we don't really expect the game to have a super high LTV at the first test. And then once you reach the right combination between LTV and CPI, it's just about pushing the button. And then, of course, making sure all the time that the metrics still hold up and it still makes sense to put in marketing money in the game. So I want to explain a little bit about like the state of mind of Umami Games and where we were when we made ABC Runner. So before that, we just published 2 other games, which unfortunately failed to scale. I think that happens a lot in general in hyper-casual. Then the last game we made was this, before ABC Runner, was this baby game. And then suddenly it was just copied by everyone. We just saw it everywhere. And unfortunately, the CPIs, they rose a lot, so we were not able to scale it. So for us, what that means that we were like super focused. For us, it was so important that we knew, okay, with the next game where we hit something interesting, we need to have the process very clear, very perfect. We need to move way faster than we did before. So for us, we focused a lot on working smarter, I would say. So how do we actually design an idea at Umami Games? Well, we do these weekly brainstorms. We chat a lot about the new trends that are out there, the ideas, what kind of market insights is there. Then for each game we make that we really believe in, we want to make into a prototype, we make this visual game design document. And then, of course, we have like a classic Trello board with Kanban tasks for the first iteration. I want to show you here, this is week one, the design document of ABC Runner. So right after we got the idea, we sketched this one up where you see to the left, you see like the start of the game, right? There are different characters, something will happen here. I'm the one character to the right. Then in the second screenshot, we see, okay, now they're running towards a gate, like something will happen here. And in picture number three, you can see, oh, it's about typing in, that's the mechanic, right? The input, typing in words with the native keyboard, and then you need to answer, here's girls' names with P. Then if you answer correctly, which Penny is a correct answer, you go through the gate. And in the picture five, you can see, oh, it's a race. It's not just about answering correctly, it's also about being fast. So that was where we started for this idea, because it had a lot of word databases. I mean, one could have hacked like a marketing version very fast, but we felt for us the best solution was to make a 2-week prototype. So that's what we did. Then, of course, in week two, it's a lot about adding. Like, so what we then do in Umami Games, when we make games, and I'll show you, what we do is that one programmer or each programmer kind of takes one of these visual design documents, they get a certain amount of time to make it into a playable prototype, and we test that one. So for us, as I said, we'd use around 2 weeks. We implemented a ton of different tracking tools, as I think almost everybody does. And then remember, this was before iOS 14, so this was a say maybe back to the better days on the release on Facebook. So back then we tested Facebook on USA, iOS. We had 5 different app concepts. And to begin with, the goal was to reach a CPR, which was below 30 cents. What I think is interesting is how similar our first design documents, if I quickly go back, actually look to like the 2-week prototype. The camera angle is a bit different, but the color and the essence of the game is very similar. So how did it go? In week three, we got some results back. This was our first test, where we were like, okay, 23 cents, could be even lower, right? But this seems promising for sure. There's something interesting here. So that's like the marketing metric side of it, the first thing we're looking at. And then that's kind of like, I would say, the marketing metrics. What we then also look at, which is for us the second priority, is like, how does the initial in-game metrics look like? And for that, we're using game analytics. So our goal in the end is to reach, I think as many other people, right? 40% day one, 10% day seven. And we want at least to have a playtime around 10 minutes. So the first test did not look that impressive, to be honest. I mean, we have like a rated average of around 23.5% day one retention, 6.3 minutes of playtime. I mean, for me, that's at least the retention is definitely not very interesting. But when that said, that was not our focus. So we thought, okay, we can work with this. So week four, we thought, okay, so we need to actually make a game out of this prototype. For me, that's always like, it can be a bit of a struggle, right? That's the hard part. Okay, I had this initial super cool conceptual idea. Now I need to make it into a real fully fledged game. Of course, we looked a lot at what were others doing, was there anything we could find inspiration in? And since Fall Guys was also very hot at that moment, we thought about this Clash Royale style. What if we had 1,000 players competing against each other? Thought that would be super cool. It was also about adding a lot more categories, more goals to the game. We also added different, of course, revenue stream ads inside of the game. And then I guess what's also the focus here is we added a ton of tracking. So I think my focus today will be chatting a little bit about which kind of tracking we added and how we actually use it actively to improve the in-game metrics. So let's see here. We implemented all the different features, which was super cool. And then we did a new test. And what we then saw was in the first two-week prototype, we didn't have the most impressive numbers, right? But then in the second test, we had way better numbers. What we do at Umami, then if a game works very well marketing-wise, we make what we call kind of a dream team, where we go in two people, or three people in one team, so me and both of our like programmers, and working a lot on just getting that one project up to the right metrics. So, I mean, as you can see, it worked very well. We managed to achieve in the second test almost 14 minutes of gameplay, and the retention also rose to almost 36%. CPI was a little bit higher, but we'd also expect that. We had not done any more marketing tests on that yet. So it was still some way to the goal, but with these metrics, we felt, okay, that's definitely doable. We should be able to reach the right metrics. So then we reach more in week six, right? We thought, okay, we need to look closer at the data. Like how does it actually, retention is one metric, right? But we want to look even closer and deeper into the data and see, could we learn anything from the information we already have of the people we already tested on? So what we have to the left out here, the left column, is all the levels going down. What I'm going to chat about today is mainly the fail ratio, which means so how many people start a level but don't complete it. That could either be because they're failing. In ABC Runner, they mainly retried the level, but we kind of saw this as a sign of this is too hard, it needs to be easier. That was our theory. Then we looked a lot at total churns, the column all the way to the right, because we had this idea that the harder it was, the more we think the churn. So we kind of wanted to control the difficulty of the game, so we could see whether that could help improve the overall churn rate and the retention. We then did some tests. I think actually before this, we did an even minor test. But the point here is that in week eight, we did a new test where we thought, okay, what if we tailor the first 10 levels? So you can see the first 10 levels is now tailored to be made way easier. We had tracking so we could see each category people answered, like how was the win-fail rate on them? So we picked all the ones that had a win rate of 90%, 98% and above. So I mean almost 100%, right? Because that was our theory. If we make a ton of very easy levels and get them into the game, like sweeped in a good way, they will stay longer. As you can see, we in week eight compared to week six have way better like green numbers. All the first 10 ones are green. And we see very clearly that right after, the levels goes from being tailored easy to being just like a random level that we don't know how hard it is. People fail way more. And it also looks like they're churning more. So what we could see here, if we look at, especially if we take the last row from level, gotta be level 10, I think here, we can see how the overall churn, which is interesting. So in the first 6 weeks version, 71% of all the players we got in, or maybe it's even closer with the right after the tournament, that in the 6 weeks version, just a ton of the players churned. You can say right after the, if you take right after the red one, we say 60% churned in the 6 weeks version, and right after the big red one out here to the right, only 40% churned. So what does that mean? I mean, overall, it means that, well, people are staying longer and retention is getting better and better. which is of course very important. So it seemed like this was the right strategy. Now I'm going to address this big red lump in the middle in the next slide. But let's see what then happened, because then we thought, how about just making all of the levels easier? How will that affect the overall churn? And what we noticed was that it seemed like it helped. So in week 8, we still had this like going very much from green to red in the fail ratio state. And in week 9, where we did way more easier levels, you can see how, okay, now they are almost green, all of them. So it looks like it's our theory was correct. If we look at the overall churn as well, you can also see in the last row that in when we were 8 weeks in, 75% of all the players had churned at level 20, right? But in the 9 weeks version, only 60% of the players churned at the same place in the game. So for us, that told us something about like, this seems like a super cool and valid strategy to improve the in-game metrics by actually looking very closely at the level funnels. So I promised to address the big red row we have in the middle. So one thing that was super good about adding the Clash Royale layer was that people stayed way longer and they had more incentive to play, and we were able to put in ads, like a retries, skip this level strategically, where we could see right here, they will use the skip button a lot, but they will not churn. But what also happened, which was not so positive with these tournaments, was that you played 10 levels, and if you win all of the 10 levels, you go to the next tournament. What we found out is once people win one tournament, like they don't really want to play that more. So we had a lot of people that churned there. So that was something we kept on looking into. We actually never fixed it completely, but we did manage to lower the churn around there as well. And you can see also down here in the next 20 ones that kind of, we saw the same tendency after each tournament. So even though it was a negative pattern, we saw it several places in the data. So then week 10, now we were very close. We knew this, like our LTV was higher than our CPI. So we knew we wanted to scale it. We also did other like in-game and data adjustments. So this is just an example of, for example, we improved the claim skills ratios, where just totally basic, had the characters in the left column and tried to figure out, so which one of these ones are the most positive ones. Mainly we did that to figure out which skins should we place first in the game. We also changed the frequency of when the skins appeared and stuff. As far as I remember, we managed to raise these numbers a lot. This was the initial tests. So that was 10 weeks in. And now as a developer, of course, you're super excited. Like you're very close to scaling the game. And one only really knows how well it will scale when scaling, right? We tried it before and sometimes it fails, sometimes it goes well, right? So we were now in, this was the second week of week 10, where we did, as you can see, we did higher frequency and more UI for the whole claim skins thing. And we managed to raise like the overall claim of skins with 6 percentage points. You see here. Then, as I said, week 11, we had to we started to slowly scale the game. Of course, one needs to watch out for the CPI. Where will it stagnate? Is there any more ad networks that we could have great CPI? Well, we haven't used the potential yet, right? Which sort of A/B test can we use and create to improve the metrics further? And I would say for me personally, it was a bit of the same as like the data-driven approach, just like in another area of the game, one can say, in another area of the development phase. I think it's super beneficial to work that way. And while then scaling, we could see that it worked very well. So for a 3-person team, it was pretty amazing. on the 2nd of February to say that our game hit the charts. It had that day more downloads than High Heels and Blob Runner, and it also had more downloads than all the apps on the entire app store, so more downloads than TikTok. So that was super amazing. The team was very happy. We were like, okay, it seems like we validated our own process, which was super cool. And just big celebrations in general. But of course, also making even more A-B tests and also newer games, right? So that was week 12. And now some time has passed since then. And I have a few takeaways that we did a few weeks after. So in general, I think data-driven development is great for small teams. I think it's great for everyone, but at least for us, it worked very well in a small team. Kind of the data-driven approach and the data helped us make better design choices. It kind of helped us to pick which direction to go in, which is, I think is always super cool as a designer, because sometimes you don't know exactly where, which direction to choose, right? And then also because data doesn't lie, right? I think that was super cool. I would also say this is more like a discussion we've had a lot in the Nordics with like how much data should one use compared to how much like artistic creativity, where probably not an issue at this conference, but I would just say for me, data-driven development also helps you sustain your game studio because you focus on the business models and not just on making cool games, right? I think that mix is super important. And for us, we have this thing we always say that like rapid development and data just optimize your chances of success. And like, who doesn't want to optimize your chances of success, right? Yeah, I think for me, that's kind of it. I could talk a lot more about it, for sure. I think maybe it also fits with the time. As far as I understood, we're going to do some Q&A. I think you guys should be more than welcome to add me on LinkedIn. I'm called Riley Andersen. You can also send me an email. We are also currently hiring people. So what happens when you make a successful game is that we were able to raise money. So now we are 7 people, and on Monday we will be 8.
Yeah, thank you very much for your speech. So yeah, that's time for questions now. So the first one is from Mert. How did you work faster and smarter to avoid being copied?
Yeah, so I think for us, like one thing we did is that, I'm not gonna bash anyone, but a lot of people had the different baby games, and what we thought was like, who do we know who's definitely the fastest? For us, we felt Rolic were the fastest. So we went in, we looked at their app store, like how fast were they actually in each version? And we were like, okay, that's our threshold. We wanna be as fast as Rolic is, because we know they're super fast. We used to, we have tested some games with them as well, so we know their speed. We think they're super impressive, and we're like, yeah, we're gonna be as fast as them. So we kind of saw how much time they used on it. We also just used a lot of planning, structuring, saying, instead of saying, how long will this take? Then maybe try to say, I have 1 week. I wanna add this and this and this. Then you also know how to prioritize how much time to use on each task.
Cool, thanks. The next one from Kyle. How did you initially find your business partners? It seems to be the hard part in this industry, especially to find like-minded people with a sense of business. Did you find your partners through networking online, forums, groups, events, or through mutual connections or friends, etc.?
I think that's a super great question, and I agree it can be very difficult. I had another company before Umami Games called Tap House Studio. We were doing a lot of different things, like should we go casual or hyper casual? What kind of happened there in the end was that we didn't have the same vision. I really, really wanted to do the straight hyper casual, very focused iteration thing. And they more wanted to to like more artistic game. They didn't have the same speed that I had the vision of that. So my first thought there, actually, I was just pitching it to a lot of people because like, it's like, okay, I had this one company, didn't work out. Now I know what to do to make it better. I need to, and I was just pitching it for people. And I was, at that point, I was like a bit tired of working with other people. So I was actually pitching it as like my own hyper casual hub. I'll just have a ton of developers that would help and they would get revenue shares and stuff. But while pitching that, I had some people I used to work at Tactile Games heard it and they were like, that is a very cool strategy. How about letting us join the founding team instead? I've also been in the like startup scene for a long time here in Denmark. And so for me, it was like through network and contacts at my old workplace. So in the industry, and the whole actually building a company and failing it is just super cool because it really makes you focus on like which kind of person are you? Which kind of vision do you have? I think it's so important to agree on the same vision.
The next question from Yagush. What was the primary age demographic for ABC Runner?
Yeah, so a lot of people think it's a kids game. It's not really. As any other classic hyper casual, there were not any specific like age group. I think maybe below 30 were even the most popular. We had a lot of traction on TikTok as well. And we saw a lot of, at least the organics came a lot from the younger crowd. We saw how they shared it a lot. I think part of the game's YouTube ability, the fact that you can play it and then like comment on what you're entering, worked very well on TikTok. They have these voice functions and we just saw a lot of people organically sharing it.
The next one from Rao. What is your methodology to process when to kill an idea or prototype?
So right now what we do, we have this phase one, phase two, phase three. For us, in order for a game to reach, and phase one is the initial prototype testing. For us, for a game to reach phase two, it needs to, yeah, now Facebook is weird, right? But before that, it was below 30 cents. Everything over 30 cents we throw out. Right now, because of the iOS is a little weird, we still look at Facebook, but yeah, I wouldn't even go into the iOS numbers there anymore. But we look at like the IPM rates, the IVR rates, like how many people install it compared to how many impressions we show. But we also look at in-game metrics. So it is definitely super hard. But for us, I would say marketability. If the CPI is too far away from what you know you can make inside of a general hyper-casual game, I wouldn't move forward with it. So I would look at marketing metrics first.
Oguglan asks, how do you consolidate your early stage marketing spendings for tests, in-house, seed partnerships, etc.?
Yeah, like how much, do you ask how much money we use, where to test and how much money we use, or?
How do you consolidate your early stage marketing?
Consolidate, yeah, yeah. Is that so how do I know the metrics are good enough, right? Yeah, it is hard to say, right? I mean, after having tested so many games, you kind of have an idea of what is the standard CPI you want to reach, right? What is the click-through rate you want to reach? Now doing this presentation, I saw that in the first test, because it was like aggregated of all the networks, that the click-through rate on ABC Runner was 3%. I would say that's a bit low, right? Back in the days, at least before iOS, it was like at least 4% click-through rate you want on Facebook. In general, I would assess all the different metrics kind of tell me something different, right? CPI tells me right now how cheap is it, like how much does it cost to get someone to install it? The click-through rate would maybe more tell like how interesting does my product seem? Like when people are watching it, how many percentage of people do initially want to look know more about it, right? So I would do like a little bit of a combination of the different metrics.
All right, and we have time for the last question. from Yogesh. Did you go through the decision process to use native keyboard versus custom keyboard or a stack of letters?
So that was definitely a hard decision because, I mean, there's positives and negatives on both. The good thing about the native keyboard is that it's super simple to implement and everybody knows it, so it feels very native in the hands of people, right? The bad thing is you can then not customize it. We actually just made a new game where we actually chose to customize the keyboard instead. I would say, though, that the non-native keyboards is not as efficient as the real native ones. Like the ones we have right now, is it seems like it's lagging a bit. Maybe the hitbox is a bit smaller. On Android, we had to, as a funny story, we had to use the like another keyboard. We couldn't use the native one because on Android, when you have the native keyboard, you cannot, how was it? If you press anywhere else than the keyboard, the native keyboard will automatically lock down. So in our game, that does, then while you're typing, if you accidentally press outside of the keyboard, it will lock down and people are like, the game is broken, right? So for each platform, I would consider whether what is the easiest solution and the best solution for the players, right?
Thank you, Riley. We have much more questions, but we have not enough time to answer them all. But all of the questions you can see in our pine and answer them in chat as well. So I think we will be right back in a few seconds.
Thank you. Thank you, Vlad. Thank you. Bye.